Thank you very much. I will try to ask the question, why do the neurologic patients are referred to for potential closure of the FLAA? Okay, this is disclosures. So neurology have three type of patients that could refer to cardiologists to close the LAA. Patient with ischemic stroke despite anticoagulation, patient with ischemic stroke unsuitable for anticoagulants, or the most discussed group, patient with intracranial MRS. Today we will only focus in the first group of patients, patients with ischemic strokes despite anticoagulations. Well, I apologize for putting this slide because I think you have seen it hundreds of times in the past six months. But I will pass quickly because it's only to say that patients with a recurrent stroke are not included in these European guidelines. But we know from the big clinical trials, the trial from the NOAC and also from the trial from LA closures and the registries, that patients on any of those treatments, they are not eliminated. We do not eliminate the risk of stroke. In primary prevention, around 1% of patients will suffer stroke despite any of these two treatments. But in secondary prevention, patients that have one stroke, the percentage of patients suffering stroke each year is between 2 and 3%. So what do the guidelines say in patients who have strokes despite anticoagulation? Well, they say they don't say it as a lot, no? They just say that we ask for the patient if they take the pills, they have the good adherence, and if the patient is well anticoagulated with warfarin. And also they will tell us that if the patient suffers a stroke or a TIA, while taking an anticoagulant, they just change from anticoagulant. If the patient suffers a stroke with antivitamin K, it's usual to change it to an NOAC, but what if the patient has a stroke with dabigatran? Do we change it to rivaroxaban and then also to apixaban? Well, we don't have any data about those issues, no? And the American guidelines, well, they don't tell us a lot of what to do, but they tell us what not to do. No? They tell us that it's not useful to increment anticoagulation or to put aspirin on top of anticoagulation because it's harmful. And they always establish a little group of patients in valvular atrial fibrillation that they could be considered the combination with aspirin or warfarin in patients with rheumatic mitral valve disease, but with a low grade of recommendation. So if we look at the European guidelines, really we do not know what to do with this type of patient. No, these have put in a section which is called gaps in evidence, and they tell us that there is a need to perform studies that they compare anticoagulants, especially novel anticoagulants, with a LAA closure in patients that have a recurrent stroke. On the other hand, in this clinical update, they establish a very interesting question. It's if there is a role for the combination of both therapies, the combination of patients with oral anticoagulants and the closure of the appendix in patients with high stroke risks. And this is an interesting survey performed in European centers that closed the LA, and you can see how 50% of the centers tell that the one of the indications for closing the LA was recurrent stroke despite an anticoagulation, although we know there are not many data in this setting, and it's the second indication just after the big indication that is patients with contraindication to anticoagulants. And in this multicenter experience with the unplugged cardiac plug, we can see like 16% of the patients, the indication was because they have stroke while they were on warfarin. But very interestingly, you see in the table in the down of the slide, you can see that at the last follow-up, only 4.6% of the patients remained anticoagulated despite they have had previously a stroke. So it seems like if we close the LA and we are... We do not have to do anything more. No? And in the Iberian registry, the data are similar. 7% of the patients were closed because of a stroke during anticoagulation, and only 4% of the patients remained with anticoagulants 1 year after the closure. What about indirect comparisons between LA closure and NOACs? You have been talking a lot about in all the day. And it's in this network meta-analysis, it seems that like the two techniques are similar in efficacy in preventing strokes with a little minor MRIs with the devices. So what are the mechanisms of stroke in anticoagulated atrial fibrillation patients? We classically say that 90% of the thrombi originates from the LAA, and it's also we saying that the patients with atrial fibrillation have a prothrombotic systemic state. But what should we do if our anticoagulation does not work? Well, first of all, we have to do what the guidelines tell us, search for another possible cause of stroke. Patients frequently have carotid stenosis or aortic atheroma, or the hypertension is not well controlled, or this stroke is a lacunar infarction. Also, we have to search for the quality of anticoagulation, if the patient takes the pill or not take the pills, and if the patient with warfarin is well controlled. But despite the knowledge that most thrombi leading to stroke arise in the LAA, rely heavily on CHA PASC score to stratify patients and anticoagulate accordingly, and none of these clinical include factors related to the anatomic or morphologic or hemodynamics and characteristics of the appendix. So recent studies have attempted to identify specific features in the morphology of the appendix that may favor local blood estasis and thrombus formation, and they're the more resistant to anticoagulants, such it is the detection of thrombus in the appendix, the presence of a spontaneous echocardiographic contrast, the morphology of LA, especially the non-chicken wing morphology, the flow velocity in the appendix, or the boarding of trabeculation within the left appendix. For example, in this meta-analysis, it has been seen that the morphology of non-chicken wing has more stroke risk than the patient have a chicken wing morphology. So, really, we don't know if there are appendix that are resistant to anticoagulants, and this term has been put in the literature. Is there a malignant LAA? Is this a new entity? What are the characteristics of these types of appendix? They could be the patients that have many of these characteristics would have a higher risk of stroke, present for a large volume, polylobulated, no chicken wing morphology, extensive trabeculation, or the presence of a spontaneous echocardiographic contrast in the left atrium. So it has been defined as a left atrial appendage with actual thrombus or high likelihood of thromboembolism originating from it despite standard oral anticoagulation therapy. So is there a role for the combination of the two techniques, closure with oral anticoagulation therapy in patients with recurrent strokes despite correct anticoagulation? That's the question. So this is the standard a scheme that we use for patients who are at risk of stroke with atrial fibrillation. Could put this one, the association of the two techniques in patients with stroke recurrences despite anticoagulation. Just to end my talk, I will tell you our short experience with a special group of patients that we have treated in our stroke unit. They are patients with these characteristics, patients with atrial fibrillation, and at least two stroke recurrences in a period of 12 months, despite correct anticoagulation with NOACs or warfarin. NOACs, we are sure that they had a good adherence, and all patients had the stroke with an NAR superior to 2 and with a good warfarin control. There was no other evident cause for stroke recurrence. There were no contraindication for anticoagulation, and all patients were studied with ET and cardiac CT. We have found 10 patients with a median age of 72 years with a CHAD back elevated and a Hasblet low, 1-3. 8 of them were non-valvular atrial fibrillations. The median number of stroke were 2 or 3 in all the patients. Patients that were with warfarin was 7, and 5 were with direct anticoagulants. Many of them had the two options. And you can see they are not major. They not have a personal history of major bleedings, intracranial bleedings, or major bleedings. The characteristics of the LA, it was polylobulated in 80% of the patient with a presence of thrombus in 20%, the enlarged left atrium had 90% and 70% had a spontaneous echocardiographic contrast in LA. And interestingly, we found that of 10 patients, 90% had the morphology of chicken wing and only 10% one of the cactus morphology. The occlusion have been performed in 8 patients. One of them will be occluded in the next couple of weeks, and the other one, unfortunately, the last stroke has led the patient in a very dramatic situation, and we have decided not to occlude it. But there have been no complication with the implants, and we have decided to continue the permanent anticoagulation, 20% with warfarin. That those are the 2 patients with valvular atrial fibrillation, and the 80% had direct anticoagulants. We also maintain antiplatelet treatment for 3 months after the closure, then we're retired. And we now have a mean follow-up of 9 months, and there have been no major hemorrhagic complications or no strokes or embolism systemic. Just to finalize, this is an example of a 48-year-old man that in 2015 was a healthy man. He played rugby. That's very strange in Spain, but this man did it, and he suffered his first stroke in January. It was a right M3 that was seated with intravenous TPA, and in that stroke we discovered that his patient was hypertension and had a paroxystic atrial fibrillation. He was put on Daviga 150, and in August of the same year he suffered a second stroke, also treated with TPA, with a left M3 stroke. The patient was changed to a apixaban, and in 1 month later he suffered his third stroke. Then in this case, the patient had to be a thrombectomy to cure the patient from the stroke. So in that time, we decided to combine the two techniques. We started dabigatran 150 and then aspirin within 3 months, and now it's 2 years after the first stroke. The patient is asymptomatic. He's not playing rugby, but he's playing golf. He says he plays well. So we can conclude in this talk that between 2 to 3% of the patients with atrial fibrillation continue to have recurrent strokes despite correct anticoagulation. It is necessary to clarify if there are any morphological or functional characteristics of LAA that could increase the risk for stroke recurrence. And while waiting for more clinical data, LAA closure could be considered in a certain group of patients who suffer stroke recurrence and have a malignant risk profile. Antithrombotic treatment could include the continuation of anticoagulation indefinitely. Thank you very much.